In the German elections, the centre-left has narrowly won against Angela Merkel's party. Hello, I'm Rob, and this is BBC News Review. And joining me today is Neil. Hello, Neil.
Hi there, Rob. If you want to test yourself on the vocabulary that you learn in this programme, there's a quiz on our website at bbclearningenglish.com. But for now, let's hear a news report on that story about the German elections from the BBC.
It was an election night on a knife edge, with Germany's two main political parties jostling for pole position as the ballots were counted. The race was so tight that the leaders of Germany's Social Democrats and the Conservative CDU-CSU union each now claims the right to try to form a government. Whoever is successful will become Germany's next chancellor. "Let the poker game begin," declared the widely read Bild newspaper in a headline this morning. Both parties are wooing Germany's Greens and the business-focused Liberal FDP party.
So, as you have heard, there's been an election in Germany and the Social Democratic Party have narrowly won that election. They got more votes than any other party. But it's not as simple as that. The parties are now trying to form coalitions with each other, and whoever does that successfully will be able to form the next government of Germany. The one thing we do know is that Angela Merkel will no longer be the chancellor after 16 years.
Okay, and we've got three words and expressions that we can use to talk about this news story, haven't we, Neil?
We have. We've got pivotal, usher in, and vie.
So that's pivotal, usher in, and vie. Okay, well, let's have a look at our first news headline, shall we?
Yes, okay, here we go. The first headline is from CNBC, and it reads, "I'll be darned. Biden reacts to pivotal German election result."
Okay, so that's pivotal, important and influential.
Yes, and we spell that P-I-V-O-T-A-L, and it is an adjective, but perhaps a good way to try and understand and remember this word is if we look at the first part of it, the word pivot. What's a pivot, Rob?
This is more used, I thought, in sort of technology and mechanical things. A pivot is a central point, isn't it, where everything else moves around it?
That's right, yes. That's exactly it. A central point where something else moves around in a machine or a device of some kind is a pivot. But we use this figuratively, very, very often, to describe something that is important and can change direction at that point. So, for example, an election victory is a pivotal moment because things can change from that point.
And we hear that word pivotal used with other words, don't we, like figure or role?
That's right. We can describe someone as having a pivotal role in something else. So let's take a simple sporting example. Everybody knows who Cristiano Ronaldo is. He has played football for Manchester United, for Real Madrid, for Juventus. He's back at Manchester United now, of course, his own country, Portugal. And in every single team, he has played a pivotal role. It means he has been the really important person who has created change around him.
Okay, so pivotal is an important thing. So, for example, if I was in the office and I changed the type of biscuits that we started eating in the office, would I be playing a pivotal role in the future of biscuit eating in the office?
Well, Rob, we all know that biscuits are very important to you, but that's not something that all of us share. So it would sound strange to describe the change of biscuits as pivotal because we use that word to describe things that are serious and important.
Okay, great. Let's have a summary now of that word. Well, as many of you know, Brexit played a pivotal role in the history of the UK. And we talked about it quite a lot on News Review. Where can people watch those videos again, Neil?
All they need to do, or you need to do, is click on the link below.
Great. Let's now have a look at your second headline.
Okay. My second headline comes from the BBC News Online, and it reads, German elections usher in political change with a small c.
So usher in, that's make something important start to happen.
That's right, and it's a phrasal verb. It's made up of two words. The first one is usher, U-S-H-E-R, and the second part is in, I-N. So together we have to usher in as a phrasal verb.
Now, I think an usher of someone who shows people into a theatre or a cinema, they show you to your seat.
That's exactly right, Rob. Yes, we have the role or the job of usher, and that's a person, perhaps, as you said, the cinema or the theatre. Also at a wedding, you could be asked to be an usher. That's somebody who kind of shows people around, tells them where to go and what to do. And it's that sense of direction, giving somebody direction, which is the same here as a verb. So we say to usher something in means that something has changed at that point and there is a new direction.
And we can talk about all different situations, can't we? For example, today the weather has changed. It started raining, the wind started blowing. It kind of means the end of summer. So the rain has ushered in a new season.
Absolutely, yes. The rain has arrived and it seems to have ushered in the autumn, finally. It's been pretty warm up until now in the UK. Also, we can talk about great world events ushering in changes. The most obvious one, of course, over the last year and a half, almost 2 years, is the COVID-19 pandemic. It has ushered in so many changes in the way we lead our lives. Just one example is the way we work. People like you and I, Rob, who work in offices, we've been working from home largely. And it seems like the COVID pandemic has ushered in a new era of home working.
Indeed. And also in history, there have been technological changes that have ushered in other developments, such as the invention of the jet plane, that ushered in a new era of travel around the world.
Absolutely. All sorts of technological developments have ushered in great change. The internet, smartphones, but as you say, jet airplanes cut the length of time it took to travel places overseas by a huge amount, and it changed the way that we lived our lives.
Okay, very good. Well, I think we should now usher in a summary of that phrase.
Absolutely.
Now, usher in was an example of a phrasal verb. You can learn lots more about phrasal verbs in English class with Dan. Where can people watch English class, Neil?
All you need to do is click on the link below to get Dan and English class on phrasal verbs.
Great stuff. Okay, let's have a look at our third headline now, please.
Okay, our third headline comes from The Guardian and it reads, German election. What happens next as parties vie to form government?
That's vie. Compete with others to gain superiority.
Yes, and here's one to pay attention to. The spelling is V-I-E. The pronunciation is vie, but the spelling is V-I-E. So it doesn't look like it sounds, unfortunately.
And vi is something we do on a big scale. So we wouldn't compete together maybe just to go and get the kettle to make a cup of tea.
No, that's right. Yes, as we said, we're talking about elections here. When we use the word vi, it gives a sense of competition which is serious and important. You vi for something or you vi to become something. You vie to become the leader of your party or you vie to become the next government. Sports teams would vie with each other to become the champions. And so we use it in that sense. It's probably...
Can we also say that they can be vying to be, for example, the football teams can be vying to be top of the table?
Yes. So it's a verb and we can use it with an ing form. But again, be careful because the spelling changes. It's a short word, V-I-E, and we lose the I-E when we're using it with the I-N-G form. So vying becomes V-Y-I-N-G.
And Neil, vie, it's a very small word, isn't it?
Yes, well, we've just said that we use it to talk about really important things, but it's a little word. And I think because of its size, it gets overused. So as we said, you and I talking about competition, we wouldn't say we are vying with each other or let's vie with each other to get to make a cup of tea. It sounds too formal for an informal or unimportant situation. So the reason headline writers like this word and the reason we see it a lot in the press is that it's short and journalists like short words to go into headlines because you can get more of them in.
Yeah, okay. So a short word with a lot of importance.
That's right.
Good. Let's have a summary. Now, Neil, do you think you could recap the vocabulary that we've talked about today, please?
Absolutely. So first of all, we have pivotal, important and influential. We have usher in, make something important start to happen, and vie, compete with others to gain superiority.
Okay, there's three words and phrases you can use to talk about the German elections, and you can test your understanding of these in a quiz on our website at bbclearningenglish.com. And don't forget, we're all over social media as well, so check us out. Right, well, that's all for today. Thanks so much for watching. See you again next time. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.